Once again, welcome to class to the lecture number 13 of the deep learning course. In this session, we are going to talk about last functions for the neural networks. Let's assume that this is the neural network I have, where something is being processed, and at the output layer, we are going to get some output, and that is going to correspond with respect to whether that input, whatever input, let's assume that the input is a image, whether it is a cat or dog or lion, what it is. So let us think that let's assume sometime an image of cat has been fed. At that time, what we expect as an output? Let's assume that the output values are S1, S2, S3. Let's assume that let's assume the values are 0 and 1. We expect that this value would be very high, for example, 0.95. Dog value would be 0.01, and this value would also be very, very less, okay, as compared to the cat value. So we would say that this is the cat. This is going to happen. So how this is the condition that we want. But actually, since we don't know that at the time when we start the system and we initialize the thing, we don't know that what these values are. Initially, these values could be 0.6 and this could be 0.8. This can be 0.5. Who knows? So how can you tell that how bad I am? Definitely, you would like to understand that what is the expected output. Expected output is 100. Okay, expected output is 100 because cat image is there, then expected output is this. So you say that you can take the term by term difference. Okay, 0.6 minus 1 square plus 0.8 minus 0 square plus 0.5 minus 0 square. So this quantity you are going to take. And for all the data items, you are going to find out this thing for all the data item. And then this error function that you are going to see, or last function that you are going to see, you want to do a back propagation to reduce this value. And ultimately, if this value becomes zero, what it means that everywhere my system is going to give is giving me the right answers. So this is the general mechanism. We have seen, I would not go into that particular detail. If you wish, you can see one of my lecture into the machine learning that I have taken. So actually, this function has a problem. This particular function has a problem when we want to do the classification. And the problem is this, that at the time of classification, what happens that this output, actually what is this? This is actually target minus output. This value is target minus output square. Target value is fixed. We know that we have fixed something that gives me the target, that what is the target value. But this output is not straightforward because there is some sigmoid there, and there is some summation comes from there is some linear combination of weights and input. So it is going to be some sigmoid on the linear combination of the weights. And this function actually becomes bad because this particular mechanism that we come up over here, earlier what was happening, that when we wanted to find out a value, at that time there was something, this W transpose X kind of things were there. So it was a linear combination. So when we differentiate, we see that this particular function was a convex function. But when we go into the classification domain, then this particular function ceases to be convex function. So we cannot utilize this kind of mechanism. So all these things, let me just give you an example. All these things we have discussed. There is another website that we have last semester. We have, when I have offered the machine learning course, at that time this was a website, ktiwari.in/ml. Here, I think I suggest you to see this. If you have any problem, then you see this lecture number 20 and 21, largest linear regression and logistic regression. So right now I'm talking about something from the lecture number 21, that is a logistic regression, that I'm telling these terms that, so here also you can see that PDF is available, video is available. If you wish, you can see that. So what I was telling, that I am telling that this function is not convex. So it takes time. If you wish, you are most welcome to see that video, that why it is not convex. So because of this non-convexity, you cannot utilize these kind of function in the classification for the classification. Okay, what should we do? So there is another proposal that actually tells that that instead of using this kind of mechanism, you use something log of that particular quantity for the minimization. Okay, log of the quantity that you are going to see at the output as for the optimization. Okay, we are going to see this formula more, but before that, let me tell you one more thing. That if you think that all the units are actually independent, because here you see that if you from very high level perspective see that this value, how this value is computed, this value is computed on these things. Okay, how this is computed, this is computed based on these things. So if you draw a line over here, you say that something has been computed, so this output depends upon these weights. Try to understand. Similarly, this output depends upon these weights. This output depends upon these weights. Same thing has been fed to all these three neurons, and they are taking output based on their weights. And there is no way to tell that how they should be related. If they are not related, so what is the problem can happen? So first problem, you can see that if we wish that the summation of these values should be something, so we cannot impose it directly using this kind of mechanism. Okay. So this is an issue. Okay, so then comes a function called softmax function. Okay, this is another very important function that is called the softmax function. What it does, that it takes all the values which are over here. For example, let me call it s is equal to what is s is equal to the output vector that actually we are going to receive. Let's assume it is s1, s2 and s3, three values we are going to have output vector that we are going to receive. So this function takes this particular quantity, this complete vector, all the values, and then if you wish to find out output of any particular unit, for example, ith unit, I want to find out what is the output of this particular unit, what should be the output of this particular unit. So it says that you put it e to the power si divided by summation of summation of e to the power sj for all the units. Okay, so ultimately, what happens that S1 was there, so you say that e to the power S1 plus e to the power S2 plus e to the power S3. And if you want to find out what is the output of S2, it is just e to the power S2 divided by this. This is the output of second, whether it is dog or not. Whether it is cat or not, it is e to the power S1 divided by this particular summation term. Similarly, whether it is line or not, then it is e to the power S3 divided by this particular quantity. So it is a very interesting equation, and in this equation, what is the first thing that you have achieved? That if you find out that what is the summation of all these terms, what is the summation? Can you tell me? Summation is going to be 1, because these terms, when they are taken summation, it becomes to this particular quantity, and at the end, what we get? We get 1. Okay. So what is the importance of this particular mechanism? First advantage is this, that summation of all these quantity, what happens? Yeah, so summation of all these values becomes 1, and therefore now we can directly interpret all these values as a probability. Okay, you may be thinking that why we are putting e to the power, etc. So all these things comes from binomial distribution. You know that most of the time when out into the very general settings, the output is going to be 0 and 1 only. And binomial distribution is more suitable to represent those kind of things, because we have seen that if you have a coin and you are flipping that, how many experiments you are going to do, then what is the probability that a particular thing is going to have, for example, 10 time head or so. If you represent those things, so these kind of equation comes to your picture. It is an exponential kind of behavior. So that's why we use these kind of functions, and this the most important requirement of this particular function is this, that first it makes sure that the whatever output you are going to get is actually the summation of that particular thing is going to be 1. Summation is 1. Now we can treat it as a probability. So first thing that we have done that output that was coming to us, I have changed it to the softmax, number one thing. always your final layer is going to be softmax. Okay, but you can apply ReLU and 10H whatever over here, but at the end, last layer, you are going to put the softmax. Now we are talking about that we wanted a expected target output. Now, but my system is going to give me the output. How can I define what is the loss when the target is this and output is this? How can we define the loss? So loss, this time we are going to use a term, we are going to utilize a term called cross entropy for the loss when we are going to do into classification domain. So the cross entropy is going to be utilized. What is the cross entropy? Cross entropy says that yi means what is the expected output, and log of that what is the quantity that that particular unit is going to give me the output. It is multiplied by y out means expected output for all the classes, for 1-2 class. Okay, so since we are good to go, we can talk about this thing also. There are two kind of different problems. So one is called the multi-label and another is multi-class classification. Okay, what is the multi-class classification? So generally, as I told you, that generally we have two classes only, 0 and 1, cat and dog. But if you have more classes, 0, 1, 0.5, cat, dog, elephant, then it is called the multi-class problem. Okay, now we have multiple classes. Okay, it is multiple classes. When we are into this particular domain, means that there are multiple classes, in that scenario it may be possible that given one image there could be a single item into this particular image. For example, there is only cat into the image, or there could be both the item. For example, cat and dog both are there. If this is a scenario where in one image more than one label are present, then this problem is called the multi-label problem. We are right now addressing the multi-class problem where classes are more, but at that time, at one time, we expect that there is only one item present into that particular image. So whatever image we are going to feed or whatever data we are going to feed to the system, it represents related to only one of the things. Okay, so we know that what is the expected output for that particular thing. What is the expected output? This is the expected output, and what is the log of this particular quantity, log of this softmax? Again, few minutes back we have talked about that earlier formulation that was actually trying to have, for example, yi minus f minus si, or into the earlier formulation what we were going to have this value. I told you that this is not a right because this is not convex. So we are instead of using this thing, we are going to use this formulation. For every class, what is see here the number of classes. So into the multi-class classification setting, how many classes we have. So in this example, 3 classes are there. Here also 3 classes we have created. Okay, into the cat dog one, 2 classes would be there. So this is a new loss function that we are going to use for what? For the classification setting. Okay, this is a logistic loss function that is very popularly utilized into the machine learning domain. Any questions on that? Let us see this function more closely. So this, what is this function that with respect to a only simple setting, that's, let's assume that there are only 2 classes, and we are going to see that what is the value of this particular loss with respect to a single example. Just pick a single example and try to see that what is the loss. So this is the equation where I'm telling that for all the data item, I'm going to find out the summation divided by 1 upon m. And for one input, when I'm going to provide, I see that for all the classes, for every classes, what is this particular value? So in this simple setting, this is no there because only one data item is there. So this particular part is not there. The value of C is actually 2. So we can write it, we can open it, we can write into this particular way that this particular complete quantity becomes what? Only the summation of 2 items. So since, let me open this and write it, then it is y1 multiplied by log of s1, y2 into log of s2. So here I am going to call loosely fsi, I am going to call it as si. Let's assume that what is the output. Okay. So here I have done the mistake. Okay, please bear with me. It is a typing mistake. We can correct it in the slide. Okay. So you understand that I have written for 1 and 2. Now you know, since there are only two classes, so if we know the value, what is the value of y2, what is expected value of y2? Okay, if this value is 0.3, I don't know, I'm just putting this thing. If this value is y1, means I expect that y1 should be how much? 0.3. Then what should be the y2? We got two class classification problem and summation is going to be 1. It is 0.7. So summation of y1 and y2 should be 1. Do you understand this? Y means what is expected output. So expected output, let's assume the expected output is 0.3 in some case, then the what is y2? Two classes are there, it is going to be 0.7. We don't know that what is the value of s1 and s2 that is coming from the network, so we take the values from there. But again, since we have applied the softness function, so s1 and s2 are also going to be related. What is s2? Because summation of these two terms are also going to be 1. So s2 is equal to 1 minus s1. This is y1 log s1, 1 minus y1 log 1 minus s1. So this is a very standard formula. I mean, sometime why I have written this formula, so that you just understand that the formula that we are going to use for the cross entropy is again the same formula that most of the time we have seen. That into the ML domain, you would see this particular formula, not this representation. It is the same representation, okay? However, few minutes back I told you that let's assume this value is 0.3 and therefore this value is 0.7. This would not be the case, because what we expect, okay, what we expect that there is one class, so therefore either this value cannot be 0.3, this would be 0.1 it would be 1 only, okay, it would be 1 only or 0 only. Okay, because it's two class classification problem, and when we are doing the classification, why we think that 0.3 probability is there? Definitely the item is there, the probability should be 1, expected output should be 1. So most of the time this is going to happen, that the y's, if there are c classes and we want to say that what is the expected output of first one, second one, third one, if we want to make the vector of yc, so this vector, can you think something about this? How, in what form this would be, in what form this particular vector would be? So you can say that, sir, one place there would be 1 and our other places it is going to have the 0. This kind of function it would be. All right, if this is this kind of function, then writing this thing, writing this kind of equation actually boils down that just find out at what location this is 1. And then the summation of this particular quantity. Am I right or not? So only this y goes away. Just find out that what is the class of that particular item. For that value, you find out what is this particular quantity. That's it. There is a question. Let me just see. Voice is a bit unclear. Is such a loss valid for multi-label classification also? So multi-label classification, we have to deal not directly. We have to use some kind of other things also. So right now I'm not treating that. So what was the typo in the second line, sir mentioned? So I was telling that this was the typo, that this, there is a f of si, but I have written si. So just bear with that. Fine. Okay. So what I was telling here that, we were at this particular point. So if you just try to understand that what is the value of this particular vector, so you can see that this vector is only one place it would be 1, all other places it is 0. So from very high level perspective, we can say that, okay, you see that only this particular term is going to survive. Forget about this thing. Find out at the right place. If you want to find out the loss, you take the log of this particular quantity. And what is this particular quantity? We have seen earlier that what is the PSP? Now I'm writing SP. SP means which is the positive class for given item, which is the positive class? For if you give me an item, what is its positive class? For related with respect to that thing, what is the output? SP. Let's assume the SP is the output for that particular SP is the output for that particular respected neuron. So you put the whatever output that you are going to do, e to the power SP, and then summation of all other units, what they are going to give you, by this you can find out the loss for that particular item. Once again, if you have any item, find out that what is its positive class, see that what is the output of that particular neuron, put it here, and then summation of remaining all other neurons at this particular place. This is how you find out the loss for that particular item. Definitely you have to find out the summation for all the items and take the average. So this would definitely be there, but this is how we can simplify this equation, and we can write into this particular way. Any questions till now? Hope this particular formula is clear to you. Yes or no? Please, everybody, please write yes or no. Is it clear? Yes. 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 Great. Okay, I am very happy. So we till now we have set our carpet. Now let us start discussing about something. I am going to tell you something very, very important. Please focus on this. So right now, this my particular example where I am telling that I am going to provide something at the output. I want to find out the output. So multi-class problem. There are multiple classes, and we want to find out here. I want to bring you another thing in your notice that we have discussed in the last class. I told you that whenever you have a neural network is going to be logically defined using some part. There are some logical parts. So if you just close your eyes and from very high level perspective try to understand what are the different parts, you can see that since you are going to give me some input, so first part A would be to find out the feature. And second part would be classification head. These two things would be there. So this is the classification head, and this is the feature extractor. And whatever they are doing after that, whatever output is going to be generated from these units, it is going to be called as a feature. Hey, what I'm telling you, are feeding some input over here, okay? And by this, you are going to get this particular feature. Are you able to get that? Are you able to get that? Once again, you are feeding an image of cat, dog, whatever. These particular things are going to do what? They are going to some kind of transformation and feature learning. And after that, you are going to get some feature. And this feature would be whatever the output of these things. I'm going to collect it at a vector. I'm going to call it XI. I'm telling that it is a feature. Yes or no? Everybody write yes, that you understand that what do I mean by feature. After the feature, I also have one layer. That layer is actually working on this particular feature and then creating the output. And as I told you that this is W1, this is W2, this is W3, and similarly different weights are there. These are the different weights. They are multiplied with the feature, and now we get that what is the output that we want. Everybody is clear about that? So after now onwards, whenever I would say the feature means what? Not this. Whenever I say the X means what? This. Okay. Whenever I say the weights means what? These values. Okay. This is our equation. Everybody is okay with that. Then how this equation changes? The first thing, that how to find out the SP for pth one. Let's assume that this is the pth unit. How to find out this? XI into WP, okay? And here, instead of P, again, I'm going to write the YI, means because P is a YI, na? What is that particular unit? So W transpose, W is with respect to, now let us understand that W is with respect to that particular thing. W transpose XI plus BI, this unit. Because you know that this is what the multiplication you get from here. You know, put it to the e to the power this, and this is your output. Similarly here, W transpose Y for all the units you are going to put into this formula. For different inputs that you have, M inputs, you have 1 upon M summation of all the items which are actually there. All right, so this is no problem. This is very simple formula, okay? Now, we are going to start discussing something very important. Softmax loss that we are going to use is separable but not discriminative enough. Softmax loss, because we are going to have this softmax loss. So because of this, this XI would be distributed in some way. Okay, because this is a latent representation of the items. This is a latent representation of items. So into the latent space, it would be distributed in some way. And how it would be distributed? We think that somewhere the similar kind of items are there. This second item, third kind of item, fourth kind of item. This kind of thing is going to happen. It is discriminative, means what? That different classes, all the features of the different classes are actually discriminated. One is here, another is here, another is here. They're discriminated, but it is not discriminative enough. Means they are not very much discriminative, because they're sometimes few items are very near to each other, and therefore their features are very near to each other. So there could be a problem, because we have not told anything. We told that into the whole space distribute this particular data. Okay, feature, whatever feature vector we want, whatever feature vector we want from given input, whatever feature vector we have requested, we only want that their activation should be such that they should be, the activation should be different. So if the activation is different, it is fine to have, for example, if let's assume just focus on this particular class, it is fine to put the point anywhere. Okay, it is fine to put a point anywhere. So however, it is not a bad thing, it is also a good thing. We have obtained that my classification is going to be correct, but it is not that much good. Okay, that's why I am writing that it is not enough. What we can do more? How can we make it more better, this function more better? Another proposal is to use center loss. What is the center loss? Center loss actually says that for whatever item, whenever you are into a one round, you see that what is the hidden representation of all these items for a particular class. You see that for this particular class, what is the hidden representation? And then you apply a summation of all the XIs divided by the number of items which are actually in this particular class only. So by this, you would be getting a center. By this, you would be getting a center for each of these clusters, are, we can say that feature representations. You will be getting a cluster. And then I am going to define, by this you find out the center, and this is CY. I am going to define that this actual value of that feature, if you take the distance of this particular feature with the center, and you take the square distance, means the distance between those things should also be minimized. This is another criteria. So the loss, the total loss that was you are going to have, the earlier one, new loss is earlier one plus this LC. So new kind of loss you are going to define. If you use this kind of loss, where you are telling that in the area where the features are defined, the distance of these things should also be minimized. What would happen? Can you suggest from here? I think in this table only you can suggest, okay? What would happen if I say like this? What would happen? Tell me. So let me tell you what is going to happen. These things now this particular point cannot stay here. Now this particular point cannot stay here because it is very far away from the center. It would move here. It would move here. It would move here. It would move here. All the points would try to move over here. So this boundary that we are actually seeing is going to be like this. Now this boundary would be like this. Similarly, these item would also be here. This item would also be here. This item would also be here. Understand? Because of this introduction, this would happen. Okay. So do you think that this is a better representation as compared to the previous one? Yes or no? Yes or no? Is it a better representation? Yes, it is a better representation. We have given this. This is a better representation. So centered loss. So this is the very interesting idea that you are going to apply another loss part over there. So whatever you are going to learn into the latent representation, it's better. Why it is better? Because if some feature comes, so if some feature comes over here, so there is nothing else nearby. So definitely you can find out other near points over here, and it would be associated with this particular thing. Because for the new item, we don't know. So new item is, if it is coming into the white space, blank space where nothing is there, very easy for us to say that in which place it lies. Because if other points are also nearby, then there would be confusion. If no other points are there, then it's very easy. We can draw a line and we can do the things more better. Because if there is a, for example, if let's only consider these two things, and let's assume that this is the separating line. So if the point is here, then lot of confusion is there, okay? Because if other points are also there, other points are not there, we can say that, okay, these points are there. It is very near to this as compared to the other things. All right, very interesting idea. But however, few problems. There are a few problems with this kind of approach. The first problem is you can know, you can by yourself assume that determining the center, where is the center, is a big problem, because data set is mostly very large. And for all the data sets, what is the hidden representation? You find out the average. So it is going to be a huge computation burden to find out this particular quantity. It is not easy to find out. Okay. And also there is sometime if you are using batches, for example, mini batch training, if you are using few item to train, then it becomes another problem because for the, now you are not using the complete database. So for this thing, there would be a different center. For this thing, there will be a different center. Then using, when you are training using batches, then it again gives you a big problem. And third problem is also, is actually very important, and actually it tells about that how come you are computing this center. You are computing using Euclidean distance, because when you take the summation of all these xi's and divide by the number of item, it is something like that. Into the Euclidean space you are going to find out that for where is the center. But when you actually compare two features are there, you want to find out what is the similarity between them. Most of the time Euclidean is not a good measure to find out the distance. Sometimes we go for the cosine similarity, and cosine similarity is more better way to find out that. So if you actually use a different kind of similarity measure, then using center is not a good idea. Make sense? So it is a good idea, however. I am telling that there are a few points that if we can incorporate, our system would be more better. So softmax loss that we had a few minutes back, let us see once again very closely that this particular quantity that was onto the e to the power this w transpose x plus b, you know that we have also earlier also said that here you include x0 also, and then you can say that it is w transpose x only. Very easily we can write like this. What is w transpose x? We know that the mathematical definition of the w transpose x is this, that you take the norm of the w transpose and norm of the xi and multiplied with the cos of theta, because two vectors, these are the two vectors, what is the theta between them. Using this thing we find out that what is the value. So this represent the dot product here we, if we say that all these weights, can I make this particular quantity as a one? What do I mean by this? After training, I do a scaling on this particular quantity, and I say that this particular, all the weights are actually, norm of all the weights is going to be one. How can I make it? Find out the norm, multiply with a number, so that norm becomes one. This is just a normalization. So you make it one, what would happen? This term goes away. Then this equation only becomes xi into cos, and that with the cos of that particular item, with respect to the particular, what is this, what is this value? This value says that what is the angle between your class and the class which you are taking the difference. What is the angle between those two things? Okay. Once again, for a particular item, if its class is I, then you take the difference with the I only. But for all other things, you would be taking the difference with the I and J. Okay, because multiple units are there. Now I am running a loop J that is called going from 1, 2, 3, 4 for all of them. If I was targeting, or for example, fourth one, then my I is equal to 4. But I would run a loop for all the J's. for all the finding out the difference that for a particular item, whatever item xi I have, I see the vector difference of from its what is the angle. This angle is between, anyway, this angle is between the weight vector of that particular unit and the xi. Okay, and I am going to multiply with the xi. So this this summation, and then at the top, at the top with respect to the right ones. This is another formula, and this formula, does this particular formula have any special kind of meaning? Do you think that this formula have any special kind of meaning? No, actually not. What happens, only one thing happens, that actually this is a very interesting slide. Only thing is happens that, let's assume that earlier this was the, here the one class item were there and another class of the item were here. Let's assume into your hidden space, into your feature space, then items would be distributed into this particular kind, means they would be distributed everywhere. They would be distributed everywhere. The positive item and negative item are distributed everywhere. But when you apply this kind of mechanism where you say that weight, the distance is going to be one only, what does it mean? That all the points are at one distance only. So what would happen? That they would be placed like this. In your feature space, all the points into the feature space would be on some kind of arc. If this kind of scenario is going to arise. Are you able to understand that? Because now the distance of all the points is what? One. Into the feature space. Distance of all the points is what? One. We have made it like that. So feature space earlier was like this, but now the feature space is like this. This is the first thing that we are going to obtain by changing this kind of formulation. The formulation is changed by this. My features are going to distributed into the angular into the angular orientation. Now all the features are angularly oriented. Let me utilize it, and we say that there is another paper that calls up the sphere loss, sphere phase, that actually talks about that. That why don't we say that instead, when we are using, look, we were using the cos of this particular quantity, na? What was my formula? That with the norm value, I was using the cos of this particular quantity. Instead of cos, I am telling that I am going to create a function. Okay, I am going to create a kernel function, and this kernel function is such that there it is minus one to the power the cos of that particular quantity. Why it is this is not that. Okay, cos of that particular quantity minus something, and this minus is going to be dependent upon the k. Means, what do I mean by this? That actually, let me tell you that this particular function is going to say that here, if it was, let's assume that it was distributed like this. Here, the positive examples were distributed like this. Let's assume that positive items are distributed like this. Negative items are distributed like this. So it says that your theta should be less than some quantity. And what is that particular quantity? There is some value, minus 2k, there is some value by which this should be, they should differ. So this one is going to reduce and another one is going to increase, because minus 1 to the power of something. So sometime it is going to be increased, sometime going to be decreased. So if the things are side by side, so for the side by side, you know that for something is going to be even then odd. For the even, it is going to be reduced. For odd, it is going to increase. So what would happen? That it would create a kind of separation. It would create a kind of separation. If this kind of setting we can come, so it is going to create a kind of separation between the feature vectors. So into the feature space, there is a separation. No item is over there. So earlier, what was happening? That this was a complete space. In this space, features were like this. And now what would happen? The feature would be this becomes of this quantity, this would be of this. So there would be some separation, because you are going to add something between them. So there would be some kind of separation. This formulation is called the sphere phase. Very interesting thing that we are going to use. We enforce a margin. Okay, and because of this, this kind of feature distribution we are going to obtain. Okay. In this equation, again, if you see that what is the importance of this Xi, again, you can say that it is also not going to be very much going to give any kind of contribution, because all the contribution is coming from this cos part only. So what should we do? Once again, this formula is very important in the term that everywhere I am going to use the cos, but for the right things, I am going to add some margin. Okay, so this, now I'm going to targeting towards the feature vector. So earlier the feature vector, whatever feature vector we were getting, we are going to use that particular norm. And now I'm going to say that instead of using this particular thing, let me tell you this thing also, that few minutes back, whatever I was telling was actually, there was some small change I wanted to give over here. That on this particular slide, I told you that things are going to become into this particular way. Okay, but let me tell you that actually what is going to happen is this, that there would be some center and this would be arc. Okay, second arc should maybe here, third arc maybe here, fourth arc maybe here, because of this the value of x. So they are angularly distributed, but these angles may be at the different distance. And what actually contributes to this particular distance is the xi. Because of the xi, it is going to happen. So people has actually thought that why not make this thing also as, let me make it also constant. So when you make it constant, what would happen? This is the actual right diagram. So this is actually the right diagram. Earlier, what I was telling, that things would be angularly distributed means what? They would be distributed into this particular area. So this is the right thing actually. That in this particular arc, things are distributed and they are distributed like this. They are distributed like this. Okay. So few minutes back, you correct it. The features are going to be distributed in an arc. So in this particular arc, features are going to be distributed. So using those kind of mechanisms, features would be distributed in this particular area. Okay, with a different parameter, you can definitely set that they are more compact. But when we say that I am going to use this as a S, what would happen? That all these things would come at this particular place and they would be here and here only distributed. This is a very interesting paper, that if you normalize here, you would be getting the things on the spheres. So you are going to get the things like this. You are going to get the things where the things are very near. Then if you increase the parameters of the distance, what would happen? That when you increase the margin, then they would be this much, and if you further increase the margin, there would be well separation of the items. So now the feature space is this in this particular kind. Okay, earlier feature was this, before that feature was everywhere. Then we said that the feature should be into this particular way only. Then we said feature should be at the distance only. There should be a space between them. Then we told that now space is going to be increased. Next paper talks about the cos phase. And what is the cos phase? It introduces a margin between the angles. It says that there should be a margin between the angles. This is the thing we are talking about, that this margin we are going to talk about. Okay, this margin. So with the cos value, some margin has been subtracted. So what is going to happen? That as I told you, that when you add the margin at this particular place, earlier the things are one by one, now there would be a difference. Now there would be a separation. Cos phase was an interesting paper, but the only issue that actually happens over here is this, that when you are subtracting something from the cars, this should also be a kind of non-linear thing that is going to be subtracted in terms of the system, because now the cars is and this is the general, because you know that m is a quantity and here this it is a angle, so finding out the difference between them is not that much easy. You know that the same value, because cos is a non-linear function, you know that cos is a non-linear function, so here the same thing you are increasing, you are getting somewhere you would be decreasing much, somewhere you would be decreasing less. So this same effect of the same value on the different values of theta are going to be different. So due to this thing, what is going to happen, that somewhere that if you try to understand that what is the difference between these two and what is the difference between these two, you can see that the difference is not uniform. Okay, somewhere this difference is here you see the difference is large, here you see the difference is lesser. So this is the issue, that when you use this kind of mechanism. However, again, this is a good mechanism. I'm not telling that whenever I'm telling that there is an issue is not like that, there is a problem. So I'm highlighting some of the things over here. Earlier, everything was, you can see that here, things were very near. There, somewhere there was a space, but when you applied, you got the distances, somewhere distance is high, somewhere distance is low. Then there comes another method that tells, after cos phase, arc phase. This is another paper that talks about the arc phase. So once again, all these papers are actually mentioned over here. I suggest you to please go and see these paper once. Another paper talks about the cos phase. It says that why don't, very simple idea, that tells that instead of using something outside, you use with the cos of theta, the angle only. You say that I need this much margin. What would happen with this? Definitely, if I say that margin is always fixed, so the problem is solved. Everywhere there would be same distance, everywhere there would be same distance, at least same distance, at least there would be this much distance. I cannot say that everywhere it would be same, at least this much plus something. So this is a very interesting paper that tells that I am going to add the things into the theta only, and because of this thing, because of this margin, the separation between the feature vectors are going to be more clear. This diagram actually talks about the same thing, that if we apply the softmax thing, the area is actually divided into two class thing. One is the one class and there is another class, but they are going to touch each other. If we apply sphere phase, spheric items are spherically distributed, so there would not be item anywhere, but here the item would be there. If we apply cos phase, so item would be here and here only, and there would be some separation. But if we apply arc phase, then definitely there would be clear margin of these particular items. Okay, all right. This is a very interesting paper, and the feature that are actually obtained by this kind of method, and various methods are actually going to be shown in this particular table. So this particular table has been borrowed from this particular paper that I told you, that paper is mentioned over this arc phase, additive angular mass for deep phase recognition. So this is an interesting result taken from this particular paper only on two very popularly known phase databases. This algorithm says that even on the very large database where 5.8 million images are there, the accuracy is 99.83% and it is 98.02%. And it is a clearly very winner with a very high margin, 97.62, 98.02, 99.73, it is 99.83. LFW was once considered to be hardest database to be tackled, but after many years when the deep feature have came, we are able to see these kind of accuracies, 99.47%. Otherwise, generally people were only getting 80% accuracies, then 85% accuracy, like that. Very slow improvement was there. And sometimes people were stuck around 92%. But after getting these kind of deep features, suddenly we were able to move to the 99% accuracy or close. So this is a very interesting another paper. I suggest you to see this. And this is a very important loss. Okay, hope you understand this particular thing. Thank you very much.